It was to have sole and exclusive power to appoint ambassadors and other ministers to foreign nations and judges of the Supreme Court. Under this scheme, it was obvious that a senator should not be allowed to step out of office at the expiration of his term on one day and be appointed by his late colleagues to an important office on the next day. It is, therefore, not a surprising thing to find this provision in the draft and to find it applied only to the Senate. On the 14th of August, Pinckney had so far modified his own views that he was then in favor of making the members of each House incapable of holding executive salaried offices while they continued members, with the provision that the acceptance of such office shall vacate their seats respectively. This having failed in convention, he, on the same day, urged a general postponement of the subject until it should be seen what power should be vested in the Senate, when, he said, it would be more easy to judge of the expediency of allowing officers of state to be chosen out of that body. This postponement was agreed to nem. con. It is manifest that the idea of the Senate being an appointing power was still uppermost in his mind. He gave good reasons for not making ineligibility absolute, but he consistently adhered to the idea that the same person should not be both a legislator and an officer of state.